All right, pleased to be joined by Avi Loeb, professor of science at Harvard University. Good to have him back. He's always got some interesting things to talk about, and boy, is that ever true today. Avi, thanks for being here. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Let's talk about the study you did. There was, let's start from the beginning. There was an asteroid that landed back in 2014, and it sort of, it piqued your interest, correct?
Yeah, it was actually an object. We don't know what it was made of, that collided with Earth. And what made it different is that it came at a very high speed. In fact, it was moving so fast that it was not bound to the sun. And it must have arrived from outside the solar system. And out there, we figured out that it was moving at 60 kilometers per second speed, faster than 95% of all stars in the vicinity of the sun. So it was very fast. And moreover, it was tougher than all the space rocks that we had seen before from the solar system in terms of its material strength, because it was able to withstand the extreme pressure that was exerted on it all the way down to the lower atmosphere of the Earth, about 20 kilometers over the Pacific Ocean, when it exploded and created a fireball that the US government sensors detected. And so given that it was very strong in terms of material composition and also very fast, we allowed for the possibility that it might be technological in origin. Just imagine Voyager in a billion years from now colliding with another planet. It would appear as a meteor that has very strong materials, in that case, steel that are making it. So we decided to go to the Pacific Ocean and look for any relics left over from that meteor explosion. And we found tiny spheres, basically metallic marbles, 50 of them, at the bottom of the ocean at 2 kilometers depth, across a region that is 10 kilometers in size. So that was a very challenging task, but we did it. And then now we brought back the materials. They arrived by FedEx to my doorstep. I realized that it took them millions or billions of years to arrive to Earth before that. So they made a long journey until we picked them up from the ocean floor 10 years after they sunk there.
Describe the spheres to me a bit more. What about them has you thinking they might not? Or are you thinking they're not human? And if so, why?
The spheres are just molten droplets from the surface of the object when it was exposed to the extreme heat generated by the fireball as a result of its friction through air. There were a few percent of the energy output released in that fireball compared to the Hiroshima atomic bomb. And that energy was deposited into 500 kilograms of material. So it melted. And what we are seeing are the molten droplets that fell down on the ocean, just like raindrops. And by analyzing their composition, we can tell, first of all, whether the object has materials different from the materials we find in the solar system in terms of the abundance of different elements. But we can also date the age of those materials relative to the age of the solar system. And finally, we could consider the possibility of it being technological in origin, because imagine melting computer screens or semiconductors. The end result would have a higher concentration of rare elements than you find in nature. And that's one way of inferring that we are dealing with a technological gadget. Another is to find a big piece of the meteor, which we hope to do next, because now we know where to look. These spherules, these tiny metallic marbles, indicated to us where the object might be, if there is any leftover piece from it.
Is from what you've studied so far on this, is it your belief that this is of non-human origin, or do you have enough info to make that statement at this point?
Oh, it's definitely from outside of Earth.
I should say it's a technological in nature.
And very likely from outside the solar system, based on the speed that this meteor had when it collided with Earth. So the remaining question is, what was it made of? And can we demonstrate that the composition is different from the abundance of elements that we find in the solar system? And that will be figured out in the coming weeks. We are basically using three laboratories, primarily at Harvard University, but also at UC Berkeley and the Bruker Corporation in Germany, to study those spherules, tiny molten droplets, and figure out what they are made of in terms of elements, in terms of radioactive isotopes, and try to figure out if it was indeed from outside the solar system, but moreover, whether it was technological in origin.
So you mean in the next few weeks, you're going to know definitively whether or not this was an alien probe, essentially, that crashed into Earth?
We hope to find more about it, yes. But one thing is clear, that if it's interstellar, even if it's natural in origin, it's a historic discovery, because it's the first time that humans put their hands on materials that were retrieved from a big object more than half a meter in size that came from outside the solar system.
You know, I do love, Professor, how open-minded you are to this. I think it's more important now than ever with what's going on with, you know, whistleblowers coming forward to Congress, talking about the fact that they believe the U.S. has crafts of non-human origin. Certainly, we've seen the Pentagon be more upfront about releasing pictures and videos. It's been a few years since you and I had the pleasure of, since I had the pleasure of talking to you. What are your thoughts on these recent developments with the whistleblowers, with the Pentagon releasing videos of spheres moving across the landscape? What do you think about this, Professor?
Well, as a scientist, I'm guided by evidence, and we haven't seen the evidence directly. The testimony by David Grush is intriguing, but he himself also did not witness firsthand the materials that were retrieved from the crash sites, as he claims to be in government possession. And so I would wait until I see more direct evidence for that. But it's definitely intriguing. And if you believe that there is no smoke without fire, then indeed it indicates that there is more for us to find out if the government would open up or declassify the current information that is behind the national security barriers. However, my pursuit as a scientist is to collect the evidence myself, because the sky is not classified, and the same is true about the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. It may be easier for us to find what's out there in interstellar space by going to the Pacific Ocean than asking government officials to reveal that information.
Speaking of the sky, tell us briefly about this project you're doing to look for objects in the sky, Professor.
Right. I'm leading the Galileo project, which by now constructed an observatory at Harvard University that is monitoring the sky 24/7 using infrared, the radio, audio, and optical sensors. And we're analyzing the data using machine learning, artificial intelligence algorithms to figure out if we are looking at a bird or a balloon, a drone, or something else, if there is anything anomalous, because the US government claims to have seen anomalous phenomena out there that they cannot identify, and we're trying to help. And of course, anything to do with national security, anything that is human-made, is of no interest to us. What we care about is anything from outside of this Earth, which should be open knowledge, open data, so that all humans will know about it, because it's not a matter of national security whether a probe from interstellar space arrived at Earth. So my hope is that through the scientific inquiry, we will shed more light on whether indeed there are unusual objects out there, and get to the bottom of it. There is no reason to hesitate to collect the data ourselves and to ask the government to do it for us, because the government is not a scientific organization. Their day job is national security.
Has that project, have you uncovered any unusual or notable finds from that so far?
We are starting to analyze data now, and you will hear about any objects we find that we cannot explain.
Finally, what's next? Are you going to continue, you say, to look at the floor of the Pacific in this particular spot, correct?
We are thinking about the next expedition, and one possibility is indeed to image the ocean floor. We know where to look, and we using different instruments than we use so far, which was primarily a magnetic sled. If you wish to image the floor, you need to use a sonar, and we have some plans about that, and that could be our next expedition. Another possibility is to go to another site where there was another interstellar meteor candidate that based on the same catalog of meteors, and we might go there as well. That one is closer to Europe.
You mentioned, before I let you go, you mentioned just before about the U.S. government maybe not being so forthright about these type of matters. Were you are concerned about them getting involved in this particular project? I mean, you're sending these items through FedEx. Was that of any concern to you?
No, I'm acting as a scientist. I have nothing to hide. I don't have any hidden agenda. And everything that we find will be transparent, part of the scientific inquiry. And in fact, I got encouraging messages from government. You should keep in mind that regarding this meteor, the most pushback that I got was from colleagues in academia. And in fact, the Department of Defense came to my defense. They issued a formal letter to NASA stating at the 99.999% confidence that indeed this meteor was of an interstellar origin. And that's unheard of. That's not part of their day job. They're not supposed to worry about interstellar space, but they came to the help of scientific research, innovation in astronomy, and I'm grateful for that. And the fact that we found those spherules at the location that the government indicated implies that their sensors are reliable, that we can rely on them detecting ballistic missiles, if any, head towards the U.S. With high precision. And I sleep better at night knowing that.
Two quick last questions. First off, are you surprised more scientists are not looking at these matters?
Yes.
You wish that was the case?
Yeah, I think it should be part of the mainstream. Instead, what you find is that the mainstream very often deals with the speculations that are not based on any evidence. And when we decide to pursue evidence, we don't find those to be supported. For example, supersymmetry was not found in the natural parameter space after investing $10 billion in the Large Hadron Collider. And then you have the dominant community of theoretical physicists over the past 40 years working on extra dimensions, on the multiverse, ideas that may not be tested in our lifetime, while at the same time we have anomalous objects near Earth that we need to figure out. You know, that's based on evidence, not on mathematical conjectures. And I would hope that this subject becomes mainstream because the public cares about it, the government cares about it. It's about time for academia to resonate with the public and the government interests. And I should say that the lesson I learned is that science can be exciting if you resonate with the public's interest. And moreover, science should not be diminished by the negative undertones that you find in social media or in academic jealousy.
It's interesting because there is evidence now for all this sort of stuff. I mean, you talk, you know, David Faber, the pilot who saw this, that's on radar as well as his own observation. I mean, there is a lot of evidence to support some of these claims, right?
Yeah, the evidence exists. It's not of scientific quality, but we can find more evidence that is of scientific quality if we just search. So when people say extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence, very often these same people are not seeking the evidence. And that is a vicious cycle because you are basically maintaining your view by not seeking the evidence. What I say is extraordinary evidence requires extraordinary funding. You need to invest in the search before you find it will not fall into your lap. And given that in physics, we are investing billions of dollars in things that we haven't found yet, like the nature of dark matter, like supersymmetry, to me, it makes a lot of sense to invest similar amounts of money in figuring out what the unusual objects, anomalous objects near Earth might be like. What is their nature?
David Grush says interdimensional. I can't even understand what that would be. That's a whole other thing, right?
Well, that's if there are extra dimensions, and I wouldn't go there. As a physicist, we have no evidence for that. It's a popular idea right now, but it goes beyond the laws of physics as we know them. As of now, all we know about are the three dimensions and time that we live in. It remains to be seen if there are more dimensions, more spatial dimensions.
Okay, my last question is, and clearly you're working on finding some hard results here, maybe sooner rather than later, but are you confident that we as humanity will get some concrete answers to these big questions? Is there life out there? Has it visited us? Are you confident we'll get some answers in our lifetime?
Yes, I am, because we haven't done the search in the way that I described. We haven't searched our backyard for any tennis balls that may have been thrown by our neighbors. You know, we assume that anything we find in the backyard are these rocks that are familiar to us. But every now and then, if you check your own backyard, you will find objects that came from the street. And it makes a lot of sense to check them, because the senders may not be alive. Nevertheless, the packages arrived at our doorstep. So in that sense, you know, it's very different from searching for radio signals, which are just like waiting for a phone call. You need the counterpart to be active when you are searching. And here it's searching for objects that may have taken billions of years to reach us. And there might be a lot of them. We just need to look out and find them.
Fascinating, as always. Really appreciate it. You have a book out, correct, Professor?
Yes. The new book is called The Interstellar. And it's coming out at the end of August 2023. And here it is.
What's this about?
It's about what we discussed, the implications to humanity if we do find evidence for interstellar objects that were manufactured by technological civilizations. And it's a very anticipated book. There is also a play that is now completed about my scientific research. There is a sculpture that being prepared about it by another artist. And there is a documentary being filmed about my research. So altogether, a lot of interest from people around the world. And I should say I wrote 37 diary reports during the expedition, and they were read by millions of people. They were translated to Spanish. Once again, it illustrates that people can care about science when they see how it's done, and it affects their lives. One of the emails I received is from a person in Denmark who said that he had a stroke 4 weeks ago, and reading my diary reports from the Pacific Ocean gave him a meaning to his life, to continuing to live. And I find those emails very moving. You know, when I entered the private jet that took us to the Pacific Ocean, the pilot greeted me and said, welcome aboard, Professor Loeb. And I said, there is no need for titles. I'm just a curious farm boy. You can call me Avi. And that's the way I feel about everything I do. I mean, it's just like a kid wondering about the environment we live in a honest way, straightforward way, by following the evidence.
Well, Avi, we appreciate what you do for being so open-minded, and we thank you for sharing your thoughts with us up here in Canada. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.